So last class, one of the things that we did was so that in the end, what we got was the CLT for finite irreducible and aperiodic Markov chains. Well, there's something that was missing. What was it that was missing? I should have watched the video for last class too. Remember what it was. Okay, there's a... I can't remember now. The variance. So basically the theorem was you take, well, okay, finite means finite state space, right? So we had a function like this. And we argued that there exists a constant, well, that depends on f, which is positive. This bit was missing, okay, such that if you take, well, you have the usual CLT behavior, right? So, I mean, it didn't specify the chain here. So you look at the partial sums of f. Well, here I'm going to say just that pi of f is 0, meaning the integral with respect to stationary measure is 0. And then, well, the theorem says that you have weak convergence of this to this. And the general proof idea was to deduce this from the central limit theorem for Martingale. So let me just remind you quickly of what we did and how you could possibly generalize it to other classes of non-IID processes. So, okay, so step one, we're basically to find a solution to the following equation. So basically what we did was define h of x as the sum from I equals 0 to infinity of pi f of x. We first assumed that this series converges all surely in L2. But then we deduced this assumption from the fact that if E is finite and P is irreducible and aperiodic, then the total variation distance for any initial measure, well, let's say delta x P, Pn, pi goes exponentially fast to 0. And then we saw that this, I said it was an exercise, that from this, well, this is just the pi f of x is equal to delta x pi f, which is equal to pi of f plus or minus the total variation distance. And this goes to 0 exponentially faster. So that, well, at least for if f is bounded by 1. So here you'd have a constant depending on the infinity norm of f. So this is essentially what was implicit in the exercise, that if you take the integral of any function with respect to this measure here, delta x pi, that this is pi plus or minus a term that's equal to the infinity norm of f and the total times the total variation distance. So this goes to 0 exponentially fast, so this difference goes to 0 exponentially fast. But we have assumed that pi of f is 0. So this, the idea was, well, given this, then you know that this series is a series of terms that go to 0 exponentially fast, therefore this converges. Yeah, you can even say this is bounded as a function of x. So it's so it's certainly an L2. And then, so this is step one. Step two was note, you write the kind of a martingale, which is as follows. You take f of xi minus p, h. As we noted, this is obviously a martingale because the conditional expectation of h of xi given fi minus 1 is precisely this. So, but the point is that if you unravel the sum, you see that this is the sum from I equals n, 1 to n, of f of xi, because of this thing here. Right? Because here you get lots of terms like h of xi, and then when you go to I plus 1, you're going to get ph minus ph of xi. Right? So we get lots of, if you rearrange the terms, you get this plus or minus something small here, which is actually four terms of some sort. In this case, all bounded, since we're assuming. So by looking at the central limit theorem for this martingale, we have the central limit theorem for this thing. And then step three, because we wanted to apply that theorem, was looking. Right, so now we've reduced the problem to a problem of martingale, so proving the central limit theorem for this. And the main step was looking at the quadratic variation and showing that it converged almost surely, or at least that it had an asymptotic behavior. And, right, so this thing here, maybe I should write it, I should write down explicitly what it is, so, and because it's going to be good, important for us, so, what is this, right? So this, by the Markov property, we're taking a condition, maybe I should write down the condition expectation in the usual way. And by the Markov property, this is, okay, here we're implicitly starting from pi. And by the Markov property, this is saying, okay, I take the state at time I minus 1. And now I'm taking the integral of h of x1 minus ph of x0. So the notation is a bit confusing now, right? Now, if you want to write this down in a more explicit form, we have the following. So let me write it down like this. So I have the expectation respect to starting point A of h of x1 minus ph of A. That's because h of x0 under this measure is this guy. And now you take A equals xi minus 1. Just to make clear that, you know, the values of this random variable, these random variables, they're not the actual process, right? We're just integrating here. And now if you take this thing here, you're going to, I claim that what you get is a sum from I equals 1 to n. You're going to get p of h squared here, computed at a, minus p of h squared, computed at a. All of this at a equals xi minus 1. Why is this, right? So one way to see it is this. So you can think, I mean, it's sort of implicit here, right? So if you fix A, this is the conditional expectation of age after one step. Well, sorry, this is the conditional variance of age after one step, right? So what's the expectation of age of x1 with respect to this measure? It's pH of A. And so you're taking the expectation under this measure of h at x of x1 minus the expectation of h of x1 under this measure. Can you see this? Does it make any sense? Okay, maybe not, because you look puzzled. But I'm just saying that the expectation of h of x1 is equal to pH of A. And this is the definition, right? So here I have the expectation of the same random variable squared minus its mean. So I just have to compute the expectation of the square minus the square of the expectation. Maybe I can put the square. Right? And so Vn, in the end, so we conclude that Vn is the sum from I equals 1 to n of pH squared of xi minus 1 minus pH of xi minus 1 squared. And then by ergodicity, right, so we have that p pi almost surely, that Vn over n converges and goes to infinity to the expectation under pi of this thing here. Right, so what about this? So yeah, so right, so and then we get the okay, so assuming that sigma f is positive, we get CLT from the Martingale CLT. Right, so what was missing was to prove that this thing here was positive. Right, so this was the only step that was missing. Well, okay, so we need some work to get to prove the assumptions of Martingale central limit theorem hold. Well, the main assumption has been proved, that we have a Martingale in L2 whose quadratic variation, when divided by something, converges almost surely. Right? We only need convergence and probability, but we have almost sure convergence here anyhow. So there's no issue about that. Then there's an assumption on the increments, right? Saying that when we look at the expectations in the increment squared times the indicator of an event, that's like the increment larger than the variance times epsilon, that goes to zero. But that's easy in this case because of stationarity. So the only thing that was really missing is this thing here. Oh, by the way, this whole proof is essentially in Verdun's book. Since I didn't write notes, it's best if I tell you this. Right, so so now the new proposition that's missing is that sigma f is greater than zero. And the way we prove this is following. So in our setting, we have that the pi of A is greater than zero for all A in the state space. Actually, this is true for any irreducible positive recurrent chain. There we know they have a stationary measure that puts positive mass in all elements. So E pi P H squared X zero minus P H X zero squared. If this is zero, well, this thing here is always known negative by the argument that this is the variance of some random variable, right, which we use. So if it's zero, we have, and because we know that pi of A is always zero, we have that for all A, P of A equals pH of A squared And now, which is the same thing as saying that P of VH minus PH, notation gets a bit funny, A squared. And this is saying, essentially, if we're thinking about this function graph theoretic terms, so we're saying that h of b is equal to ph of a for all a in e, and for all b in e with a p of a b positive. Right? So the only way the variance can be zero is that if the random variable is almost surely constant, but it's a random variable. The distribution here has a discrete support, right, on these points here, right? Now, if we look at this, so let's see, what am I trying to do here? Right, so let's say I have fix M, which is fix M and R. Let let AM be the set of all points for which what is it called? Let's see. Right. So pH of A, I think this is what I want to do. Let's see if that's what I want to do. I think so. And then, let's see. No, but this is A and B, and now I'm not. No, I did something wrong here when I thought about this, why the proof of this was simple, because I did the proof in the reversible case, which is a much, now because what is reversibility, right? So well, one consequence of reversibility is that if No, that's not right. Now, reversibility is sort of trivial, so there's nothing to prove because we have the spectral decomposition of the chain, so it's not going to do much. Yeah, it's very odd because sometimes when I have to prove something very simple, I think it's very simple, and then I don't know how to prove it. It must happen to other people as well, but it's sort of embarrassing when it happens to me. Because this is supposed to be. Right, so it's just They're just saying, okay, if I know one age to be constant, if I have age constant in neighborhoods of A, right, so I know that I minus P of age of A is equal to F of A. So this thing here is telling me that age of A minus F of A equals age of B for all B neighbors of for all B with B A B positive. And right, so but what about this? Something. No, this is not right. It's not right. So I did all of this to get to the point where I don't know what to do. That's all. Because this should be the. I should. I mean, let, okay. So let me just say what you. When the reversible case. Well, I mean, the reversibility doesn't matter too much what this is. But let me just say, in certain cases, we're in the finite set, right? So. And. what do I mean to say here? Yeah, well, I guess that's not so good. So again, essentially, I mean, when there is one case in which this all of this gets even simpler, which is the case where you can diagonalize P in the appropriate basis. Right? And you have real spectrum for P. This is sort of what reversibility means. But this is not, I would like to give a more general proof because the reversible case is sort of the trivial one. I don't know. There's something very simple that I'm missing here. That's very annoying because it's the second time missing it. Usually my memory only fails once on a given topic. It fails several times, but on different things, right? So it's that should be the easiest thing. Anyway, okay, I'm really sorry about this. But, right, so this is sort of trivial. This doesn't need it anywhere that I can see. So, yeah, so you have something like age of B minus age of A equals F of A for A. And I guess that if So if yeah, but this doesn't say much. So let me just say, okay, so kind of the usual. Which is slightly more complicated than what I said now, but the usual way to compute. Age via so-called Frobenius theory. And then f greater than 0 is more or less automatic. And maybe I should just say a few words about this and then leave it at that. And right, so the way you compute age and the mysterious function that I'm trying to deal with now is that we want to solve an equation like this, right? And one way to solve this would be to say, well, if phi minus p is invertible, I could just say this. But this is not good. Because obviously this matrix is not invertible. I'm going to give you a function that belongs to the kernel of this matrix. So it means it's not invertible, right? Because the constant that's constant and equal to 1 is this kernel. So the matrix, strictly speaking, doesn't exist. If it did exist, it should, I mean, if we sort of believe in power series, which tell us that this is equal to 1 plus z squared, right? Identity minus p by spectral mapping and stuff like this should be something like what we wrote when we defined h, right? So there's something that must be going on here, except that this matrix is not invertible. But what the Perron-Frobenius theorem guarantees is that this is not a real obstacle in the following sense. So given the conditions of reducibility and aperiodicity, that essentially the spectrum, okay, that should say that the spectrum of P consists of one and another set. Here, one has multiplicity one. So we know what the corresponding eigenvector, the right eigenvector is this guy. And all the other eigenvalues, they're between, they belong to minus one, one. Actually, they belong even to the smaller set. So the Perron-Frobenius theorem is a theorem about matrices with no negative entries. And in the Markov chain setting, it says if you have a matrix which is reducible and aperiodic in the sense that we're used to, then the spectrum of the matrix has one eigenvalue of largest absolute value, and it's non-negative, and it has a non-negative eigenvector, which is this one. And then the other eigenvalues are strictly between minus 1 and 1. Well, they could be complex. So they're contained in the unit ball. And there's more here, because because we have another thing here. So the eigenvalue 1 corresponds to two things. One is a right eigenvector, which is constant and equal to 1. And the other one's a left eigenvector. Which we also know what it is. It's pi. Right? And it tells us that if you have a vector f, which I'm also thinking of as a function, so it's a this is such that pi of f is 0, then f belongs to the span of eigenvalue lambda I, which belongs to an unit, well. Right, so the theorem, if we use it fully, gives us several conditions. One of them is to say that, if I have an f that has zero expectation, in our case, then it must necessarily belong not to the span of this eigenvector, but of the other eigenvector. So it means that f is equal to the sum of alpha I psi I for a standard choice of coefficients here. Now, if we can so we want to apply, say, p n f, we get a sum like this. Right, it's just saying that these eigenvalues with eigenvectors lambda I. And remember that the absolute values of the lambda I are less than 1. So I can define age as the sum, well, as this, actually. So that when I apply I minus p, I get this f. And this is really is the sum from n equals 0 to infinity of sum of alpha I lambda I to the n psi I. And this is precisely Pn of f. So everything here converges, everything's very nice. So the things we prove probabilistically by saying, well, we have this contraction until the variation distance when the chain is finite, therefore we have a convergent series, everything. Everything follows from the spectral decomposition here. Or, I mean, these eigenvectors, they're in general not orthogonal or anything like that. So this is not in general a symmetric matrix, right? But we have this very powerful theorem that tells us how to decompose things like this. And what is it called? Yes, and then there's a condition that's missing here, because which is really the condition of reversibility, which I said that sort of I need to have eigenvalues of either reversibility of eigenvalues of multiplicity 1. Otherwise, I may have Jordan blocks here in the general decomposition of the matrix. This is not forbidden by this theorem. But and then it becomes a little bit more complicated, but it's still the same thing. So basically, these guys would be something. There would be these Jordan blocks here. And now I have here the Jordan block. So vectors corresponding to OK.
this.
Lambda eigenvector lambda I. And now I have the Jordan block, so it's slightly uglier. But I get this, and here I can put just identity minus ji f minus 1. And this becomes ji to the n. So the difference with Jordan blocks, you remember, you may remember what Jordan blocks are, right? So you have this thing here which has lambda I on the diagonal, and you have 1s here. So in general, when you take powers of these guys, you don't get powers of the eigenvalues. It's just you get, it's more complicated, right? But still, these matrices are such that if the diagonal entries are not 1, then they're invertible. It's a property, so I mean, a matrix like this, the only eigenvector it has is lambda I, right? It just comes from, what is it called? Yeah, so the only eigenvector it has lambda I, it might not be diagonalizable, right? So it's that's exactly the case where you have matrices that are non-diagonalizable. Well, they have one eigenvalue, even though they have dimension larger than 1. But you can, given that this is the only eigenvalue, so if this is ji, you have that I minus ji minus 1 must exist. The only way for this matrix not to be invertible is that ji has 1 as an eigenvalue. That's not the case. Right. And all of this I'm saying, I guess, just to say in the end, that, have a description for what? For age and a sum of I minus j I. Yeah, except the notation here is not right. I need to do this more carefully. So this is, should be, this shouldn't be I, this should be the diagonal matrix corresponding to I in the right basis. Yeah, so let me put this over here. Because it's the same thing. And again, I mean, it's a property of these matrices you might have seen, for instance, in an ODE class. And when you take powers of them, they are sort of well-behaved, right? So the powers are not just taking powers of the diagonal, but you get a bunch of extra terms. But the extra part is what's called nilpotent. So at some point, you take more powers and it sort of disappears. So you get convergence here. So you get this in terms of the Jordan blocks. And, right, so we get, we know that pH acts as a, just as a multiplication here on the Jordan blocks. And I guess that all I wanted to say is that the traditional way to prove, I mean, I'm not even going to do it because I want to know how, but I'll just say, well, the traditional way to prove sigma f greater than 0 is to look at this. To look at this guy. And I'm not sure what the right reference would be for this, but what I'm gonna do in any way, I'm gonna look it up and put in Dropbox. I'm sorry about this, but I should know how to make this calculation, but it somehow I can't. Okay, I had forgotten I had to do it for today, so I didn't look it up, but when I was gonna do it, I was very confident that I knew how to do it. But anyway. Okay, and I mean, there's a long history of looking at this kind of thing, doing sort of, it's not quite explicit, right? But there's a long history in more applied probability of looking at these expressions really in terms of matrices and doing approximations to them to estimate variances and things like that in more applied contexts. But I think I'm going to leave it at this, especially because I want to move on to a completely different topic today. And where... Oh, yeah, no, but there's something else I want to mention, which is how you prove theorems for more general things, so which is suppose... Okay, so suppose you have a... You have a general ergodic process, or a kind of ergodic measure. A usual shift space. And suppose you want to prove something, you have a function f of a specific kind, which makes it, which is the function that just cares about what happens to one coordinate. You want to prove a central limit theorem for something like this. And you can be much more general. Can think of functions of several coordinates or maybe infinitely many coordinates. But here I'm thinking I have a function of a single coordinate, which I'm adding over an orbit. And I want to figure out what the central limit behavior of this is. And I'm going to assume, okay, P ergodic. I'm going to assume that E of F of x 0 is 0. So... So the point is this. So right. So assume that f, maybe f is a bounded function. It doesn't matter too much what assumptions you want to put on it. What matters is the kind of thing that you need in order to prove a central limit theorem for something like this. And here's the kind of thing that you need. I know that f is 0, so maybe I should define first f I or z I being equal to expectation of f of x I given f 0. So, in particular, f of xn is just it's z0 shifted by n times. Right? Because here you get just f of x0. Right? So just have to shift in order to get. So assume that variance of Zi the sum of the variances of zi's. Just say if the variance of zi it goes to zero, fashion of saying something like this. So essentially, I need that the variances are summable, right? But here I'm saying something a bit more specific, which are that they decay like a power of I and the power is greater than one, which certainly ensures that they're summable. Sorry, I want something a little bit stronger. I want that the L2 norms are summable. Then I can define this random variable h here, which is the sum from I equals 0 to infinity of zi, and this converges. Actually, under these assumptions, almost surely, and in L2. Well, L2 convergence is just a matter of computing the L2 norm, right? The sum of the L2 norms here under this condition is finite. So you have a convergence sum in L2. And because we have some sort of tail control, we can even get almost sure convergence. Maybe I need this to be, okay, I keep increasing the exponent, but let's see. If I have the tail goes to, okay, let me put a larger exponent that I'm sure works. You need something, maybe 3 would work, but larger than 3. 10 certainly works. And then I'm going to say something afterwards about how you can prove something like this in general. Right? It depends a lot on the process. The point is that if you look at this series, this is sort of the analog of the sum of PIF, right? Well, this is sort of PIF. And this is the analog of the sum. And then what this does is that if you look at the age composed with sigma n minus the expectation of age composed with sigma n given fn minus 1, I claim that this is going to give you exactly so this requires some thought, but it's going to give exactly f of xn. This will give you exactly, this is the sum, I'm taking a, I need one more shift here. This is what gives you f of xn. And now, the only thing that makes this complicated is that you have to realize that when you take conditional expectations here, you have to multiply maybe this thing by an event in fn to see what this looks like. And the point is that somehow you can do things like, you have a random variable like this. What is its conditional expectation with respect to this? So maybe you have to prove things like this. Which is not terribly hard to see why it should be true, right? So this is saying, okay, I'm shifting v, and I'm asking, what does it look like respect to fn? What I'm saying is that, I look at v respect to f0, and then I shift. Right? So I hope there's a ring of truth to this. And then the martingale that we're going to use is mn, m sub n, h of sigma n minus e, and fn minus 1, you have to take j here. Sum from j equals 1 to n. And this is basically the sum from I equals 1 to n of f of xi. So this is the analog of the De Morneglia that we found in the more general case. Right? And when you have this, then if you and then you have to do some calculation to prove the central limit theorem for this. It's again a stationary process, so things are sort of nice. But so this is a general idea. So I mean, in general, if you want to prove a central limit theorem for a dependent process of any kind, as long as it's ergodic, then the first thing you should try to do is to replicate what you did in the Markov chain case. Right, so, and the question of usually is, how do you prove that the variances go to zero? What does that mean, right? So I claim this is some sort of mixing condition. Right, so let's assume for simplicity that f of x is an indicator of an event A minus the probability that x0 belongs to A. So f of x0 is 0. Right? So this is one simple case, one A of x. It's a bounded function, so it's very nice. Okay, so what's zi? Zi is the probability that xi belongs to A given f0 minus the probability that x0 belongs to A, which is the same thing as the probability that xi belongs to A given f0 minus the probability that xi belongs to A by stationarity. So I think you understand whenever I say a process is ergodic, I'm assuming implicit that it's also stationary with respect to the same shift transformation, right? Right, so and zi is bounded by 1, right? So bounded an absolute value by 1 because it's the difference of two no negative terms between 0 and 1. So the L2 norm of zi is at most the L1 norm of zi, which is equal to the sup for W measurable with respect to belonging to L infinity of F0. I'm just going to use this ugly notation of expectation of WZI. And now you're going to get something like, okay, so. And you can even, I mean, it's sort of an exercise to show that this is at most to the sup over events belonging to L infinity. This is a general fact, right? So events belonging to L F0 of EZI indicator of B. Oh, actually, you can get from here to here, right? So this is the integral of the positive part of ZI, which is a sup over these expressions. And then you have the integral over the negative part of zi. Right? In this case, you actually have the integral of zi, the expectation of zi is 0, right? Because it's the difference between these two things. So the integral of the positive part and the integral of the negative part are the same. So you actually only need to consider one of them. And this supremum here is the integral of the positive part of zi. Right, so the point, why did I try to get to this expression? Right, so let me say, let me just point this out quickly. That's that zi plus is equal to the sup for b belonging to f0, since it's an f0 measurable random variable, of ezi 1b. This is equal to ezi minus, because E of zi is 0. So the sup equal to a half of E ZI plus plus E ZI minus, which is just the L1 norm over 2. So it's actually equal here, if you want. Put a 2. Okay, so what about this? So in the end, what the point is that we EZI indicator of B is what? Is here you're going to get probability of XI belonging to A intersection B, right? So when you put the indicator here times this, you get the integral of indicator of B times the conditional expectation. You can take out the conditional expectation because this event is F0 measurable. And then you're done, right? So because then you get this. Right? And the other part is going to be P of XI belonging to A, PB. Well, one thing that should be clear here, which I think I didn't mention, well, actually there's two things that should be clear. I need two-sided processes to make this true, because I want Fn to be the sigma field generated by all guys that come before n. So otherwise, I have problems here. I want to have a two-sided shift. The reasons might not be terribly clear here, but they're sort of clear here. So what I'm looking at, so the variance of ZI is less than the sup, and I'm just gonna take a sup of a much larger class of events of B belonging to F0, or just say B belonging to the sigma field generated by XJ, J less than or equal to 0, and C belonging to the sigma field generated by XI, of P, B, intersection C, minus P, B, P, C. Or twice this. And this is really the kind of thing that you need to control in order to prove, in general, central limit theorems, which is you need to look at the correlations between events that happen in the past and events that happen in the future, right? So if you can prove that this goes to 0 very fast, then you're done. Because then, well, in this case at least, when you're looking at this simple class of functions which are indicators, then you're done. And actually, this is not very dependent on the fact that we got this specific function that only looks at the process at one time. You could take a function that looks at this time and the next 10 times, or even the future, the complete future, you get something similar to this. So the point is that in any case, what you have is that this is like the mixing properties that we studied, right? So the probability of intersections, we are talking about an event that's in the future and an event that's in the past, and how that decays when the time separation goes to infinity. The point here is that in this case specifically, if you have a bound for this, then you're essentially done. You have the central limit theorem. We need some minor argument to prove that things behave well, but other than that, you're fine. And this is something that people really do. I mean, there are different versions of this calculation depending on which kinds of functions that you want to consider. But so in any case, we could have proven the theorem for Markov chains just starting from this general property here. In the Markov chain case, the finite Markov chain case, we'd be able to show that because of the properties we assumed, that this thing here goes to 0 exponentially fast. It's basically, you get something even better. You can get the conditional probability of C given B minus the probability of C goes to 0 exponentially fast, which is even stronger than this. But for other classes of processes, that it can be much more complicated in principle, but still this sort of thing is done. So they're like called so-called ultra-regressive processes of arbitrary orders or Markov chains on non-finite spaces, right, which we haven't considered much, or big. You can still get this prove this sort of property. So In any case, this is proving that this goes to zero fast is much weaker than having a finite chain. It's a much more general condition. And maybe I could give you a list of things for which this condition applies, but I don't think I'm going to do that. I can answer questions if you're interested in referencing. Right, so in any case, what I wanted to say is that in general, if you have a process like this, or a ergodic process, the main difficulty in proving a central limit theorem is proving some sort of property of decay or correlations or loss of memory for the process. Right? If you have that, and if memory is lost fast enough, then you're done. Right, so that's it for this topic. Now I want to move on to something completely different. Now it's really going to be completely different. And so this is the last topic in this course, so kind of the beginning of the last topic. This course, and now comes a time when I must ask you, well, how many of you know what a metric space is? Let me try to use the convention that I always have a metric space and put the metric with the subscript. Right, come on, what are the axioms of metric spaces? Well, okay, first let me, I'm going to start. There's a set. Dx is a function from S squared to R. Oh, so this is the metric, right? So as you probably know, you seem to be too quiet, but so I'm scared, but I just need to remind you what this is. So, okay, give me a property of a metric. What? Positive? Tá bom. I want to complete this with a quality. If, and only if. Okay, it's also symmetric, right? So what does that mean? Okay, I'm gonna write it for you. And there is one thing that's missing. Okay, I forgot to say it's an unempty set. Right, so if you don't know anything about metric spaces, now is the perfect time in your life to learn something by Wednesday, because we're going to be doing lots of things with metric spaces. So I actually have some lecture notes on my website from an Análise na Reta course when I did all this stuff. Right, so here's a theorem that's, okay, so let's say there are a few properties that metric spaces may or may not have, right? So one of them is that And I'm just going to write the set, just going to use notation. And I'm already sort of, you know, I'm going really fast here. So. All right, so a metric space is complete if it has that same property that the real line and Euclidean spaces have, that when you have a Cauchy sequence, meaning a sequence where the differences between terms go to zero, then this implies that this is a convergence sequence. X is x, call the limit such that dx max and x equals to zero and it goes to infinity. And there's a second property. That x is separable if there exists a countable set which is also dense, meaning that for all x and x, there exists an element of z and d with dx, zx, less than x. Right, the important, so separable means that you have a countable subset which is dense. You always have a dense subset which is just the whole metric space, but if you have a countable subset, then it's separable. Of course, both the real line and Euclidean spaces are separable when complete. We're going to use this name, which is a kind of a very funny name for me, you know, at least was very funny for me when I first heard it, I just say that we have a Polish space separable and complete. Okay, so I'm going to state a theorem here, which is it's actually, you just need a completeness for it to hold. But it's a limit that we're going to use afterwards. And I don't really want to spend any time trying to prove it. But it's the proof is in my lecture notes on metric spaces, so you can look it up. I'm going to put these notes in Dropbox as well. Right, so, well, okay. The theorem is about compact. Okay, so I'm going to I just need completeness. Now I'm gonna have a bunch of equivalent conditions for a certain subset of X. First one is that it's compactness in at least one of the ways that are used to it. And that if you have a sequence, it always has a convergence with has a converse subsequence with limit in K. Right? This is what we use. It's compact. Every sequence has a converse subsequence. One easy consequence of this is that for all f that from K to R continuous, there exists a point in K with f of x star equal to sup of f of x for x and k. This is easy, right? So just say, well, we take xn such that the value of f of xn gets closer and closer to the supremum. You find a convergent subsequent, and you're done. This is less easy, which is saying k is closed. And totally bounded. Totally bounded means something very simple. It means that there exists for all r 0, k can be covered by finitely many balls of radius r. And it's sort of interesting because we usually learn this is a consequence of 1, right? But it also implies 1. And then there's a kind of a topological version, which, OK, I already talked about balls, so somebody, you know what those are. But yeah, so for all open coverings, of K contain finite subcoverings. Actually, I mean, the easiest way for me to prove this is to prove that 1 implies 2 implies 3 implies 1 implies 4 implies 2.
Or something like this.
But, I don't think there's any easy proof that goes kind of the most economical way, in principle. But, no, actually 2 and 4 are not that hard to show, to show their equivalent. So it's not so bad. It's sort of easier if you just prove 1, 2, 3, 1, 4, 2, or something like that. Yeah, so sort of the most interesting direction, in some sense, is this one. Saying, well, if K is not closed, so you have a set. Well, it's a set that's not closed. So it's a set whose complement is not open. So essentially, it's saying, well, there is a boundary element here, which you can approach arbitrarily well by elements of K. So if you take, so this guy, say it's called x tilde. So if you take f of x equals to g of x tilde, this is a function, or minus this. This is a continuous function on k, which does not achieve its supremum, because its supremum is 0, it's achieved outside of k. Right? So this is so k is not closed, it doesn't satisfy 2. Now, the other part is saying, well, if K is not totally bounded, then it doesn't satisfy 2. And what happens is that if, OK, so this is K not closed. And K not totally bounded what you have to prove is that you can find It's not entirely trivial, but what you show is I can find some r prime greater than zero and infinitely many disjoint balls of radius r. R prime, see. It's some sort of argument, but it's not too hard to find. But then, okay, you have these balls and they're disjoint, right? So they're all over the place. There are infinitely many of them. Now, what you do in order to get it, so you want to prove that there's a function that it doesn't achieve its supremum over k, right? And the function is very simple. So you just put a little function here, something like, this is a function 1 minus distance from x to this central point here, divided by r. Plus, or something like this, right? So this function, if the distance is larger than r is 0, if the distance is equal to 0, then it's 1. And then you put twice the same thing here, except that you have a different center, twice the law, and you put 3 times the same. Okay, this is, I should have drawn this much smaller. So this is twice, this is 3 times, this is 4 times, this is 5 times, and okay, so if you really want to be safe, you reduce r so that you get radius 2r. So that here you have r prime, and you have a positive distance between these balls, right? So the distance for, okay, even better, 4r prime. Because then you know that the distance between two balls here is at least 2r prime. So you can build this function sort of locally on each ball, and because there's a positive amount of space between any two balls, you have a continuous function defined over all the space, which is 0 outside of the balls, and is equal to one of these in the balls. So, and then you have a lot of freedom. You can put whatever you want in here. So one thing you can do is just to take functions that are going to infinity. Right? So you just have an infinity in your ball, so you can make this infinity tall. So, and then you know if it's not totally bounded, it doesn't satisfy this. And then 3 implies 1 is the usual diagonal argument, right? So you just say we have a sequence here and find a Cauchy subsequence, right? Because it's closed, so if it's Cauchy, it converges to a limit in K. So you just say, well, cover the space by balls of radius 1. One of them contains infinitely many points of the sequence, right? Now you take that subsequence and cover the space by balls of radius 1/2. One of these balls will contain infinitely many terms of the sequence. You repeat and repeat, you take subsequences, and then you do the usual diagonal trick to find a Cauchy subsequence. And then, well, a 4 is different, but it's not too complicated. Okay, but we're gonna use this this lemma, and actually I'm gonna show you that I'm gonna do something very quickly here, which is to show you a result that's gonna be very important for us. So we're gonna be proving lots of results, or a few results at least, on probability measures on Polish metric spaces. And as we're going to see, we're going to need a result that sort of, well, okay, so here's a kind of problem that we're going to face when we build Brownian motions, say, or prove the invariance principle. Essentially, here's the problem. So we're going to have a sequence of probability measures over some x with a Borel sigma field, right? So here I'm assuming that we have a Polish space. I'm omitting the metric, but the metric is implicit here because this is a sigma field generated by open sets, usual Borel sigma field. And when we have a sequence like this, and our goal will be to prove that these measures converge weakly to something. We know what weak convergence means, so let me just say it in the line. So there are many definitions on the line, so there's one definition that we can extend easily to Polish spaces, which is to say, i.e., for all functions from x to r, which are bounded and continuous, and you have that the integrals converge. So this is a definition. What does it mean for a sequence of probability measures to converge to another measure? It's this. We're going to see that, as in the line, we have a several equivalent redefinitions of this. But in any case, we're often in the most important cases we'll consider here, we're going to try to prove this sort of indirectly. In one case, at least, we don't even know that there is a candidate for a limit. But we have to prove that there is a limit anyhow. Right? So that's the same. And usually, the way we're going to do this is in two parts. So we're going to prove. Now we're going to characterize the potential limit. Say, well, if the limit exists, it has this characteristics, these characteristics, and therefore the limit, if it exists, it's uniquely defined by these characteristics. Right? And second step is to prove what we could call pre-compactness of the sequence Pn. What is a pre-compact set in a metric space or a topological space or whatever? We're going to see, by the way, that the space of probability measures here is a metric space as well. It's also a Polish space. But what is a pre-compactness? Well, you say a set is pre-compact if every sequence in it contains a convergent subsequence, right? And so it's essentially saying that the closure is compact. Well, you need to work a little bit, but say that. But what's the point here is that, well, if you have a pre-compact sequence, at least one subsequence converges, right? If you characterize all potential limits of subsequences and say, well, there is only one potential limit, then the whole sequence must converge to that limit, right? So it's saying, it's like a sequence of real numbers that has exactly one accumulation point converges, well, or bounded sequence, whatever. So this is the kind of thing we're going to do. So I mean, I'm just trying to give you an idea what's going to come up. So we're going to be very naturally faced with an abstract problem. OK, let's give a name for this space. OK, you have x, dx, Polish. And you have the space of probability measures. Over x with a Borel sigma field. And the question is going to be, when is a subset of this space precompact? And I'm going to, oftentimes I'll just write this M1 instead of writing M1 of xdx. So, well, it turns out that this is a problem about measures, right? So it's about families of probability measures in a Polish space, but that has a lot to do with compact subsets of this guy. Theorem, that's Prohorov's theorem. And that, okay, make change the letter here. S is precompact if and only if it is tight. Meaning that for all epsilon greater than zero, there exists a compact subset of x, and we're just going to use the symbol to say compact subset such that the infimum of mu of k for mu belonging to the family S is greater than or equal to minus epsilon. Again, this is a very abstract theorem, but it turns out that's the right theorem to have for many, many settings, including constructing Brownian motion or proving that things converge to it. And so we're going to have to deal a little bit with these abstract things. But there's something about this theorem that I've already run out of time, but OK, I'll keep you here for another 10 minutes, maybe, or 5 minutes, hopefully. I mean, it's not even, But certainly a family consisting of a single probability measure should be pre-compact, right? So you take a sequence there, it certainly should converge to something. But it's not entirely clear that a single probability measure is pre-compact. That is tight in this sense here, right? That you can find a compact subset that takes a measure, right? So let me show you this, and then next class we'll do the first, we'll do this theorem, or most of it anyway. Proposition. Okay, let's say the mu is a probability measure on x dx. Then for all epsilon, you can find a compact subset with a mu of k greater than 1 minus epsilon. We're going to see, next class, one of the things we're going to see is that if we have a convergent sequence of measures, we can get this more or less for free from this proposition. But now I'm talking just about a single measure. And remember, I mean, I'm talking about general complete separable metric spaces, right? So there's nothing that says that, like in Rn, compact sets are abundant. You just take any closed bounded set, it's a compact set, right? So we're talking about things that could be spaces of functions, say, where we know that's not the case. But still, you have this result, and the reason is very simple, right? So proof. Okay, take Rn equals, say, to 1 over n. And let n d contain an x dense and countable. Right? And so we know that x is the union. Okay, so let me assume I have enumerated the elements of this space. Okay, x is the union from I equals 1 to infinity of b di Rn. Right? Because, given a radius, I can always, given any point in the space, I can find a point in my dense set that's within that distance from it. So if there exists some index m of n and n, and such that the measure of this union here is greater than, say, 1 minus epsilon 2 to the n. And here I'm going to take away 0 just in case. It's just saying, well, if I increase this number, I converge in an increasing fashion to x. Mu of x is 1. So there's some, at some point, the measure is larger than 1 minus whatever positive number I want. Right. So, and actually, what I'm going to do now is this. So, okay, so how do I define k? It's very simple now. It's the intersection over n equals 1 to infinity of the union from I equals 0 to m sub n of the closed bounds around those points. So what's the measure of the complement of k? Well, if you take a complement of an intersection as a union, so the measure of a union is less than the sum. And you take then the complements of these guys. And these unions, well, OK, the complement of this. This is a union of closed balls, so it's larger than this one. And we know that the measure of this thing would be larger than 1 minus epsilon divided by 2 to the n. So the complement has measure less than, take the sum from n equals 1 to infinity, epsilon 2 to the n, which is epsilon. And how do we know that k is compact? Well, because first of all, it's closed. And okay, so here we're going to use some topological properties. One of them is that if you have closed sets and you take a finite union, you get a closed set. Right? It's just like on Rn, but except it's not Rn. So if you take a finite union of closed balls, you get a closed ball. Or, sorry, closed set. And then an intersection you take of closed sets is also closed. And how do we know the case totally bounded? Well, that's sort of a construction. Okay, given some r greater than 0, find n with rn, which is 1 over n, less than or equal to r. And note that, okay, less than r. And note that K is contained in the union of B, D, I, R, N, closed. That by construction, right, this intersection of these guys. And this is contained in the union of the open balls. So it means that, okay, so we conclude that K is covered by M sub N finitely many balls of radius R. And that's for any R. Right? So one of the criteria that I just erased, as usual, is that a set in a compact in a Polish metric space is compact if it's closed and totally bounded. Right? Totally bounded meaning exactly this, that given any radius, you can cover it by finitely many balls of that radius. So we have closedness from the construction. It's an intersection of closed things. And we have total boundedness also from the construction because it's contained all these things. And that's it. So it's, to me at least, this is not entirely obvious that you can always, somehow when you're talking about, even if you have a very complicated probability space where you can have continuous functions and we know that, for instance, if you look at all continuous functions from the unit interval to R, it's not that obvious who the compact sets are. Actually, that's the statement of Azelaskoli theorem. Right? But even then, if it define any probability measure in this space on the Borel sets, then it's essentially supported over compact sets. One of the things that this implies is that there exists a union, increasing union of compact sets with total measure. Right? So in some sense, these spaces are always sigma compact in some sense. But, right, so here's the clean abstract statement of this. So next class, we're going to see that when you have a convergence sequence of measures, you always have this property. Well, we have to first discuss what convergence means. And then we're going to set the stage for Prohorov's theorem afterwards. Okay, thanks.